We're going to talk about Mars today. So we have a presentation on Mars. I want to talk a little bit about what's happening right now on Mars. And then we have a planetarium show and one song. Mars is really interesting to us right now because we're interested in sending people there. Mars is about half of the diameter of the Earth. It has a very, very thin atmosphere. It's mostly made of CO2. It's a good prospect for people. It's got about the same day. It has seasons. It takes about 2 years to go around the sun. It has seasons because it has a similar tilt to Earth. So Earth is tilted about 23.5 degrees, and Mars is tilted about 25 degrees. It's got ice caps similar to Earth. It doesn't have a magnetic field, and we're not sure why. And it used to be volcanically active, and in the past there was tectonic activity. And I want to talk about what happened in the past on Mars. But before we even look into that, it's interesting to note that we've got Venus, Earth, and Mars, and they're all almost in the same location of the same solar system, but they're completely different. Mars and Venus are the two most similar places to Earth. They're similar in size and mass. Again, part of the same solar system. They have similar interior structures to the Earth, but we find nothing like what we find on the Earth, and we don't see any life on Mars or Venus. So, we have a rover right now that's on Mars, got there in 2020, called Perseverance. And the place that it's exploring is called the Jezero Crater. The Jezero Crater was not the only place that we were definitely going to look at. There was like 60 locations that scientists looked at for determining where we were going to land this thing. And it took like 5 years to determine where we were going to go. And Jezero Crater was selected because there were two impacts that happened there, and it was the most likely place for life to have possibly been in the past, and one of the easiest places to look for life. So the main things that we want Perseverance to do is look at rock samples, and look at soil samples, look at what the atmosphere is like. We're actually filling tubes with the intention of going back to get the tubes that are filled with some of the surface from Mars. So they're going to drill, or we're drilling about 2 inches down, that's about 5 centimeters, with these and putting material into these pre-cleaned tubes. I was surprised when I imagined these tubes, like I imagined them being really, really big. So I was surprised that like we're only filling each tube with about 1/2 ounce of material. And there's about 38 tubes. Some of them are going to be filled with nothing, just so we can make sure that we're doing everything right. And then about 30 of them will be filled with some of the surface of Mars. And we want to take these tubes, not right now, but later, like maybe in the 2030s, but we all know how missions get delayed, but maybe in the 2030s, go back and actually retrieve these tubes and bring them back here. So each tube will be sealed and stored on the rover, on Perseverance. So it's going to collect these samples, bring them with it, and then move around with it, and then we'll decide where we're going to drop these off. And they might all be dropped off in the same place, or they might be dropped off in different places. So Jezero Crater is this like ancient delta that was once flooded with water. and you can look at it and see the different layers. So it's kind of like a tree, like when you cut down a tree and you look at the different part, the different rings of a tree, you can look at different times in the past of Mars by looking at pieces of rock that formed at different times. So we should be able to look back about 3.6 billion years to see what was happening. So there's two main things that we're going to be looking at when we look at what we're looking at, like what we put into these little tubes. So we want to find carbonates and clays, and those are different than like volcanic rocks, because within those clays we can find hopefully find past signs of life, and also figure out what the climate was like over different time periods. And then volcanic rocks are really great because we can use them to determine the age of that sample. So we want both of those things. And we want to see, like, was this place as friendly for life as we think that it was? And if it was, for how long? And was it friendly for life and then not friendly for life and then friendly for life again? So we're really interested in looking for past evidence of life. So there's different science objectives, and there's also different goals that Perseverance has. So we want to look at the geology and study like the history of what the surface of Mars was like. Astrobiology, figure out, again, was it suitable for life like we think it was? Get those samples. And then also another science objective is to look at what we need to do to send people there. So like test different technologies, like a piece of a spacesuit, for example. Take that and test it and see if it holds up to the conditions like we think that it will, so that we can one day have a human presence on Mars. So the science objectives are similar to the goals, and the goals are to find out if there was life in the past. We've never found any evidence that, any absolute evidence that there was definitely life anywhere else in the universe except for the Earth. We want to look at what the climate was like over time, geology again, so like what the surface was like in the past and now. And then the fourth goal is to figure out how to get humans there. We want to look at whether or not we can find some like biosignatures of past life, and also if it would be habitable, possibly. I mean, we know it's not for humans now, but would it be possible for some sort of microbe or something? And this is really interesting because it's the first mission where we're actually like physically looking for past microbial life, whereas before the rovers were looking more for whether or not it could have existed. So that's all pretty cool. We want to put people on Mars. So the first thing that we want to do is make sure that people can orbit Mars. So that's the first thing we want to do. And we want to do that with limited cost and risk, basically. We want to get people to the surface. We also are thinking about, and this is all part of the Perseverance mission, putting people on maybe one of those two little potato moons, Phobos and Deimos, and then having like a presence of humans that stay on Mars. So we want to look and see how we can use natural resources that already exist there that could help us support life and might be fuel for us. So we hope to do that like in the 2030s. And so We've got a lot of really exciting things happening on Mars right now. Lots of cool missions from the past, and we have a planetarium show about Mars. And then one more thing after. So we're gonna go ahead and start the planetarium show.
Control is telling us now that things are proceeding very smoothly with the fueling, and they're topping off the liquid oxygen in the S1C, the main stage of the mighty SLS rocket. All going very smoothly at T-minus 40 minutes.
All flight controllers, listen up. There's something I want to tell you. From the day that we were born, we were destined to be together in this room today. We are attempting to expand the horizon of humanity and take a profound step in the evolution of the human race. No journey in history was more hazardous or more difficult to accomplish. We will sail uncharted waters. Now, the safety and the success of this mission will rest on our shoulders. But I have absolute confidence in everyone in this room. And I want you to know something. Whatever happens to us during the next 1,000 days, I will stand behind every decision that you make. However it goes. When we walk out of this room, we walk out of here as a team.
Launch Control, this is Houston. We are go for launch.
Commander Robert McGee is joined by pilots Amy Flores and Otto Hoffman, flight engineer Anatoly Nikolaev, astrobiologist Daisy Evans, and geologist Hana Takahashi.
We're ready to fly.
These men and women are about to become mankind's first interplanetary travelers.
Houston Iris 1, where to go? Let's light this candle.
Godspeed to you, Iris 1.
Iris 1, this is Kennedy Launch Control. Close and lock your visors. T minus 40 seconds and counting. We are transferring to the capsule's internal power at this time. Orion's onboard computers have primary control of all the vehicle's critical functions. Coming up on a go for auto sequence start. We have a go for auto sequence start.
Tomiko, you're go for staging.
Main engines cut off.
Roger that. We see Miko.
Staging. And ignition.
Iris 1, Houston. We see good thrust, good engines. You're right down the center line.
Free drift.
Pilot Amy Flores is now performing the docking maneuver with the Mars Transfer Vehicle, or MTV. This will be the crew's home between Earth and Mars. For the next several weeks, the crew will remain in low Earth orbit, doing some home improvement, if you will.
Contact. Soft dock. Latches and hooks. Extending. Hard dock. Vestibule pressurizing.
Mars is our neighbor. We are both flying around the sun, but it is going at a different speed than we are, and it is farther away from the sun than we are. So there's a lot of math involved to figure out the best time to launch, which is when the Earth and Mars are in opposition, or at their closest points in their orbit. This happens every 26 months or so. You must also calculate where the planet will be when the spacecraft arrives, not where it is when it leaves Earth. Not unlike jumping from one speeding train to another.
Iris 1, you are go for TMI. Roger. We are go for TMI. We confirm ignition and the thrust is go.
There's ignition. That's the word from mission control. The burn will provide enough thrust to increase the speed of the spacecraft to about 40,000 kilometers an hour, or what is known as escape velocity. This is a big deal. They cross the point of no return. They are destined for the red planet.
Iris 1, Houston, your go for the AG-1 spin-up.
Houston, Iris 1, we're go for the spin-up.
Spin-up for artificial gravity has been initiated.
Humans in space have never had this comfort before. Artificial gravity. Due to the centripetal force of the spinning spacecraft, the crew will be able to live with their feet planted firmly on the floor for their 7-month transit. This will alleviate the adverse health effects of prolonged weightlessness. The artificial gravity generated is similar to Mars gravity, which is 38% of that on Earth. The crew will also start to adjust to Mars time. Instead of a 24-hour Earth day, they will adapt to Mars sols, which are 37 minutes longer than Earth days. So during their 7-month coast to Mars, the crew has plenty of time to acclimate to the new planet.
Hey, Daisy.
Oh, hi, Robert.
The hydroponics growth looks amazing.
It's great, isn't it? 0.38G is so much better than 0G. The plants just love it.
What's the necklace?
Oh, it's the British Beagle 2 lander.
Really?
When I was 8 years old, it was Christmas Eve, and my parents let me stay up late to watch the British Beagle 2 probe Mars landing on TV. I waited up all night. I was desperate. But desperate to see those first pictures from the surface. They never came. Beagle 2 never contacted Earth. I woke up on Christmas Day, crushed. But I knew, from that day forward, one day I wanted to walk on that surface myself.
Good for you. You've come a long way.
Yeah. And now my son, James, is the same age. In the end, boarding this ship became the hardest decision of my life. Still so many miles to go.
Months into their long voyage, the Iris One crew is about to do something irreversible. They will perform another critical engine burn, the Mars orbit insertion. The goal is to end up in orbit around the red planet. But if the burn is not successful, they will swing by Mars and disappear into the void. The Mars descent vehicle is cutting itself free from the Mars transfer vehicle. This is the start of the maneuver that should place humans on the surface of Mars. Mars is so far away from us that it takes radio signals traveling at the speed of light 13 minutes and 48 seconds to reach Earth right now. So there will be no direct communication between the crew and mission control during the entry, descent, and landing. In the next 7 minutes, there are only two stark options. They will either be safe on the surface, or they will be lost.
Flight controllers, lock the doors.
Iris One, we see your turn to entry attitude, your go for EDL. Guidance recommendation, you're clear to land. You're number one in the pattern. Go for EDL. We'll see you on Mars.
Go for EDL. We'll see you on Mars. Roger. Understand. Go for EDL. See you on the surface.
We are in power descent. Vehicle delta, nominal. Velocity, 10 meters per second. Altitude, 40 meters. UHF is good. Touchdown confirmed.
Houston, the Pentheus plane on base here.
You can tell the world that we have arrived.
Roger that, Professor Spartan. There's smiles galore down here in the room and around the world. Thanks for a job well done today. Congratulations.
I thought I'd live to see this day. Commander Robert McGee is descending down the ladder, and one can only wonder what would go through a man's mind at such a historic moment. The first woman is setting foot upon Mars now. Astrobiologist Daisy Evans, with us in our studio, is a very special guest, her son, James Evans. James, did your mom promise to bring you anything back from Mars?
It would be nice if she could bring me a stone.
That would be very nice. Do you have any worries?
Well, I hope a spaceship is going to work well with the engine, you know, because it's a long way to Mars and I hope it would be very nice if she could come home again.
I'm sure she's going to make it home and that engine will work fine. And I know she's very proud of you for joining us here in the studio tonight. Thank you.
You're welcome.
The international flag of planet Earth shows seven rings, which form a flower, symbol of life on Earth.
This flag is a reminder that we should all stand united. Celebrate life itself. It reminds us that all life is connected, one way or another.
This is the first time in history that there are humans on two planets. Today we have touched Mars. There is life on Mars, and it is us. We are on Mars. We are the Martians. The crew's first priority on Mars is to set up their base camp by interconnecting modules, which landed over 2 years ago during the previous opposition. Pilot Otto Hoffman is busy deploying a weather station on the roof of the habitation module. The average temperature here is minus 60 degrees Celsius. The atmosphere of Mars today is composed mainly of carbon dioxide. It is roughly 100 times thinner than Earth's, but it is still thick enough to support weather, clouds, and winds. However, these winds lack the power to be harmful to the crew. The main mission requirement for the crew on Mars is follow the water. This is what explorers have always done. Find a dependable source of drinkable water. It usually means the difference between life and death. Today it appears that all the liquid water on the surface of the planet has either been vaporized or frozen by the extreme temperatures. Waters hidden beneath the surface might finally reveal the truth of the planet's distant past.
Amy, what's the fuel cell status?
The three fuel cell purge heaters have been manually activated. We're ready to go.
Hey, Otto, what's today's weather forecast?
The weather forecast is the same as yestersol and soloro. Clear and sunny and freezing cold.
Whatever happened to the right stuff? Thanks, Otto. Now get your butt over here and join us to Gale Crater. Over.
Shining down like water.
good old Curiosity rover. Otto, Anatoly, prepare for EVA.
I remember this rover very well. It made the second best landing ever on Mars.
Second only to you, right? Don't quote me on this, but this looks like a fine piece of American engineering. Oh, too bad we have to rig it.
Anyway, its wheels broke a long time ago. In the name of science, this will look good in the Smithsonian.
Don't forget, our local science team cares more about rocks around here.
These rocks have been submerged in freshwater lake bed, but it was in ancient times. This whole planet is drier than driest desert on Earth. It hasn't been a single drop of rain for millions of billions of years. And yet, these rocks hint to a wet past. 650 million years ago, Mars and Earth started as sister planets. There were two blue planets in our solar system.
Earth and Mars were suitable for life at the same time. I've always found that staggering. And as soon as Earth was habitable, life was there.
It's the freakiest show. Is there life on Mars?
Well, the first question is, was there life on Mars? That's why we're looking for traces of microfossils and biomarkers in these rocks. And we're monitoring the atmosphere for methane. Most of the methane on Earth was generated by microbes. So there's a good chance that the same process was or is happening on Mars.
Right now, we are measuring that the methane levels in the atmosphere of Mars change with the seasons, and nobody knows why.
But the most exciting possibility is its biological activity, because you'd expect life to be seasonal. But there could be other explanations.
Speaking of methane, I think I'm going to go check the methane levels in our rocket engines for our trip back.
Sounds like a plan.
And this is our ride home, the Mars Ascent Vehicle, or MAV. Hey, Otto, can you tell us what you're doing over there?
Sure. Like all true pioneers, in order to survive on Mars, we have to live off the land. I am checking a chemical reactor inside our Mars Ascent Vehicle. It takes carbon dioxide from the Martian atmosphere and combines it with hydrogen, which we brought from Earth. It produces water and methane. The methane we use as rocket fuel for our way home. And we like to drink the water, but also derive oxygen from it so we can continue to breathe. So I think right now, we can all agree that I am doing the most important job on the entire planet.
Okay, Otto, if you say so, just don't break anything on our precious ship.
She ripped it 10 times or more. It's about to be ripped again. As I ask you for this on the...
And after more than 500 days on the surface, the celestial mechanics are bringing the planets back into alignment so the crew can prepare to go home.
15 souls to go. I miss feeling the wind in my face. I miss jumping into the ocean. I miss cherry blossom parties with friends.
Of course, Japanese food. Of course. But most of all, I miss James. I can't believe we've been separated for the last 2 years. And I've still got one more Christmas to go without him. The Beagle has landed.
To say goodbye to a great ship. The MTV has been through the mill with 1,001 days and many millions of miles on the odometer, as it were.
Standing by for entry interface. Guidance officer confirms that Iris 1 has reached entry interface. The moment of truth for Iris 1. And as expected, we've reached the loss of telemetry as we enter this brief blackout period. This is the point in time where the Orion capsule would be experiencing its peak heating of some 3,000 degrees Celsius as it barrels through the Earth's atmosphere.
That peak heating period is a particularly perilous phase of the mission. As the capsule enters the atmosphere, hot gases form around it. It creates a plasma, which makes it impossible for radio communications to go to or from. So the crew is on its own, hurtling toward the Pacific Ocean, the USS Anchorage and its crew standing by, ready to receive them. All we can do is watch and wait and hold our breath.
30 seconds till end of blackout. We are standing by for AOS. Iris 1, Houston. Iris 1, Space to Ground 1. This is Houston. How do you read?
Houston, we read you loud and clear.
Drogues have been deployed. On mains, everything looking good. Good reefing reported. Three good main shoots reported from the USS Anchorage. That's confirmed here in Mission Control. From a high speed rate of 40,000 kilometers an hour to a gentle return back to Earth.
It was an honor flying with you all.
Focus tonight, everybody!
It's one heck of a good flying machine, but a lousy boat. We're happy to be back home. We've got 1,001 days on the clock.
The Iris One crew is signing off.
All right, we have one thing left. So that's what we hope to do one day, go to Mars and have people on Mars. We got one more thing to do, and then you can head out.
Let me know when you're ready to put me a hitch.
Okay. Thanks, Sam.
And we're still live on Facebook, too.
All right.
Great job. Great job.
All right. right, we're all done for tonight. I hope you had a great night, and come back to see the Back Bay Amateur Astronomers.
All right.
That was Professor Leah Flax and Professor Kevin, which I don't see behind the thing there. Very good job. Very good.